welcome you to Great Bridge United Methodist Church, where it is our hope that no one misses out on God's grace. We're so glad that you've gathered today to join in our time of worship. My name is Will Montgomery, the lead pastor. For those who are here in the sanctuary, welcome. For those who are worshiping online, we're glad that you are taking part in this time of worship. Before we begin our worship, I invite you to stand and greet one another and offer the peace of Christ to one another. Before we begin our worship, I have a couple of announcements that I want to bring to your attention. We are not having our Beyond Sunday program on this Wednesday or the following Wednesday, but we are having several services this week for Holy Week. And so we have a Holy Thursday service where we gather together and share in Holy Communion. We'll gather in the social hall for that, because all up here will be all the orchestra instruments for the next night. Will be a service of Tenebrae. Our choir and the orchestra will be here leading us in that service of darkness. And so we hope that you'll come on Thursday for the Thursday service and for the Good Friday, the service of Tenebrae. On Easter, we're having our normal services at 8:30, 9:30, and 11 o'clock. But we also are adding an Easter sunrise service. And that'll take place at 6:30. And hopefully it will not be as windy as it is today. But if it is windy, we'll have some protection here. We'll be in the prayer garden. Our service will take place in the prayer garden as opposed to outside where it's been in the last several years. And so you can gather through the sanctuary doors or through the foyer in the office area and gather in that space. We have some benches if you need to sit down or like to sit down. You can stand up. You also can bring your own chairs if need be. Also, we have palm branches in our hand today. Next Sunday when we gather together, if you want to bring some cut flowers with you, we'll have a cross that'll be considered a flowering cross, where people put the flowers on that cross, and it'll really come be a vibrant and vast array of colors, and it'll also be a place to take pictures. And so we hope that you'll bring your flowers with you as we gather for the Easter celebration. On April 14th, I'm offering something called Pie with the Pastors at 7 o'clock. It's an opportunity for those who've been visiting the church and want to learn more about the church and how to join and what membership means. But if you just like pie, come on out, 7 o'clock, and we will share some pie with you in conversation. So that's on the 14th at 7 o'clock. There's a shift in this service today, and we gather and we'll offer the theme of Palm Sunday when we gather, and we'll have a processional, and then we'll move from the palm to the passion. And so you'll see that shift after our men will sing their anthem. But also, as the share in the joy of this day on Palm Sunday, what I'm going to do, instead of sitting up here and during the prelude, I'm going to walk to the back, and I invite any children who would like to participate in the Palm Sunday parade to come with me in palm branches. And if there's any child who's older than a child but still a child of God, if you want to participate in the parade, come back there and join with us. And what we're going to do is we're going to come in and we're just going to walk around the sanctuary during the opening hymn, and we're going to finish here and we'll have our children's moment at that time. So in a moment, I'm going to invite the children to come with me to the back. So let us now prepare our hearts for worship as we gather on this Palm Passion Sunday. And any children or parents who want to walk with them, you're invited to join me in the back. Thank you. Hear now the proclamation of the entrance into Jerusalem. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you'll find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. And as they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12.
Good morning. I invite you to stand as you are able for the call to worship. This can be found in the bulletins and also on the screens behind me. I will read the lighter text and you the bold. Hosanna to the Son of David.
Hosanna.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna.
Please remain standing for our processional hymn, All Glory, Laud, and Honor, number 280 in the hymnal. The words will also be on the screens as we worship God this Palm Sunday morning. remain standing. I'm sorry. You may be seated. Please join me in the opening prayer this morning. The words are found in your bulletins and also on the screen. Let's pray. Almighty God, on this day, your Son Jesus entered the holy city of Jerusalem and was proclaimed king by those who spread their garments and palm branches along the way. Let those branches be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our Lord and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life. In his name we pray. Amen.
If there are any other children who'd like to come up for children's time, you're certainly welcome to come at this time. You already did. That's right. You know, I'm so glad that you already did. Wasn't that fun? We don't do that every Sunday. Should we do that every Sunday from here on out?
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll just parade around and look at all the parents and everyone else here. It's a joy to be able to gather in this day of worship as we share in Palm Sunday. And I noticed something. As we were walking around, I saw a lot of the adults were filled with joy. And I just knocked my earpiece off. I'm so sorry. I'm filled with joy to be able to share in this experience with you as we kind of paraded around. And we're remembering the day that Jesus had come to go into Jerusalem. And there were people like yourselves and adults and teenagers, and a lot of people were out there with great expectation that God was going to do something wonderful in Jesus, that they thought Jesus was going to do something different than what Jesus actually did when he died upon the cross. And so we wave our palm branches. Can you wave your palm branches again? So we wave our palm branches as a sign of victory today, but also back then when they were waving palm branches, this was actually a sign of revolt. Can you say revolt? Revolt. That doesn't sound like something that we should be waving about. They were shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, save us. And what they wanted is that they wanted Jesus to come in and get rid of the Roman rule and let them just be. And yet Jesus knew that they needed that Jesus came to be the Savior for all of humankind. And so Jesus was willing to go to the cross and die that we might live. And so
they
did. And that's, isn't that crazy? In fact, Pastor Devon's going to be talking about how they went from Hosanna, Hosanna to crucify. And we're like, how did that happen? And yet it's very interesting that there was this idea that they were wanting Jesus to save, but they had a different idea about how Jesus would save. But yet we know that Jesus did bring salvation. We celebrate how God loves us. So we have our palm branches in hand, kind of like if you're at a parade and you might be waving a flag, or if you're a certain fan of certain teams, you might have their colors that you're waving. I'm a Steeler fan, and so I have my terrible towel, and we're waving for a win. They were waving for the branches that God would win for them, but in a different way. So we're thankful that God did offer a great win in Jesus, where Jesus went into Jerusalem, and he died upon the cross and rose from the grave. And so we can wave these palm branches as a sign of victory because we know how the story ends with God's great love. So let's put our hands together and be in prayer. Repeat after me. Dear God, we give you thanks for your love for us. We give you thanks for the Palm Sunday parade, for the joy we have in you. Hosanna, Hosanna, save us, O Lord. We love you, Jesus. Amen. You can go back to your seats or go to children's moment, children's message. Be friends.
keep silent. I'm going to shout in victory. Rocks, keep silent. Jesus reigns in majesty. Ain't no rock going to shout for me. Rocks, keep silent. Ain't no rock going to shout.
From the Gospel of Mark comes from Mark chapter 15, verses 1 through 15. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and the scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered him, "You say so." Then the chief priests accused him of many things. And Pilate asked him again, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you?" But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again, "Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Crucify him." Pilate asked them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him." So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Let us stand now and sing hymn number 301, "Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross." gospel lesson continues in Mark chapter 15. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort, and they clothed him in a purple cloak. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him, and they began saluting him, saying, "Hail, the King of the Jews." They struck it with a reed and spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And they offered him mixed wine and myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "Aha! You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling Elijah." And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come and take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was God's son." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? O Lord, my God, my rock and my redeemer, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen. I grew up in Middlesex County. Every year, the first weekend in October is the Urbana Oyster Festival. School is canceled and the roads are closed down because the buses can't get into town to pick up and drop off the children. On Friday night, there's a fireman parade, and on Saturday, there's a different parade. On Friday night, the towns all around us come from all over and they bring their fire trucks, their best and their brightest, their oldest or maybe their newest, and they blast the town with the sound of sirens. On Saturday, there's a different kind of parade. It's a little quieter. There's floats and antique cars and decorated golf carts and marching bands and the pageant queens. Great Bridge loves parades too, doesn't it? I've never seen a place set up chairs weeks in advance of the awaited Christmas parade. We just had a little parade of our own as we entered this house of worship, waving palm branches and singing "All Glory, Laud, and Honor." It's what we do as we begin to mark this time apart as Holy Week. In our scripture for this morning, we find ourselves in another parade as Jesus makes his way into Jerusalem. But as Marcus Borg and John Dominic Crosan note, Jesus' parade wasn't the only one that was taking place in the city that day. Every year on Passover, pilgrims would flock to Jerusalem to worship and remember. That was a time for people to get away from their normal routines and be united as a people of faith. For some, this might be a once-in-a-lifetime journey to Jerusalem. This Passover celebration was a time when the Jewish people celebrated the ways that their God had delivered them and liberated them from the oppressive Egyptian Empire long ago. Because the Romans knew what this celebration marked, the Roman governor of Judea would come down to Jerusalem to keep the peace and to make sure the citizens didn't get any big ideas about liberating themselves from any other empire anytime soon. Kristen Adkins Whitesides noted that there wasn't just one parade, but there were two, one entering from the west and one from the east. Pilate processed into Jerusalem through the largest gate, the Western Gate, riding a war horse with cavalry, soldiers, banners, troops all marching behind him. The streets were cleared and large crowds gathered to watch the display. And none of the pilgrims who had gathered to worship in Jerusalem could miss the point being made. Their celebration of the Passover was only happening at the tolerant pleasure of the Roman government. On the other side of town, another more ragtag procession had begun. Jesus rode a colt down the Mount of Olives on the east side of the city, surrounded by a crowd of followers. They spread their cloaks and palm branches ahead of him, and they shouted, "Hosanna," the treasonous chant, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David." Pilate rode a war horse through the largest gate in the city, decked out in armor with banners and waving troops marching behind. And Jesus rode a donkey colt through the small eastern gate. He wore no armor and was followed by small children waving palm branches instead of banners. There were two parades that day into the city, but they couldn't have been more different. One was military might on display, and one was a small protest with a poor band of rebels crying, "Hosanna," or as it's translated in Hebrew, save us now. You see, Hosanna is no simple cheer. It is a prayer, a plea, a protest, and it paves the way for what will come. For Palm Sunday is a day that of contrasts, as we are confronted with the choice between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of Caesar, between Jesus and Barabbas. We recognize on this day that it is this contrast that is central to the story of Jesus' life and to our understanding of the gospel. As Borg and Crosan note, the confrontation between these two kingdoms continues through the last week of Jesus' life. As we know, the week will end with Jesus' execution by the powers who ruled his world. Holy Week is the story of confrontation, and Palm Sunday is its beginning. Two processions made their way into Jerusalem that day, and as we move through this week, we will witness the confrontation between God's way and the way of the world, the human way. Our way. We witness the way that Jesus becomes a threat to our way. If we continue to follow Jesus in this procession, we will join him in an upper room as he talks about betrayal and denial and the way that love looks like humble service. We will watch as he breaks bread and pours out the cup and tells us that these will be reminders for us of his broken body and his shed blood, physical reminders of his suffering love. We will gather with him in the garden and watch as he prays and pleads for his life. We will watch as his most committed followers cannot sit and pray with him without falling asleep. We will watch as he is led away, arrested, and betrayed. If we continue to follow Jesus in this procession, we will follow him all the way to a trial, as the cries of Hosanna are drowned out by the shouts of Crucify him. If we continue to follow Jesus in this procession, we will follow him all the way to the cross, as the crowds who had once gathered to join Jesus in protest now chant for his execution. How do we get from the crowd crying, Hosanna, save us, to a crowd that shouted, Crucify him? We end up with this contrast because Jesus did not come to satisfy the crowds. He does not come to align himself with the religious experts, nor does he come to serve or confront Rome. The people cried, Hosanna. They wanted him to save them, but they didn't understand that how he would save them was to take the place of a guilty man on the cross. They didn't understand that Barabbas, the son of a father, was all of us. We are all the sons and daughters of a father, while Jesus is the son of the father. In Mark 11, 12, and 14, the religious experts are trying to figure out how to trap Jesus in his words, but they are treading carefully because they don't want to upset the crowds. He figures in Mark 14, they have somehow enraged the crowds, and while Pilate doesn't want to release a guilty rebel, he also wants to keep the peace. Pilate wants to satisfy the crowds. He figures when he offers them Jesus that the people who have been following him are going to ask for his release, and that he won't have to let Barabbas go, that he won't have to do what the religious experts are asking, not because Pilate is sympathetic to Jesus, but because he doesn't want to let Barabbas, a violent rebel, go, and he doesn't see Jesus as a threat. Jews didn't like Romans, and Romans didn't like the Jews. It's possible that Barabbas was respected because he stood up to Rome. The innocent son of the father takes the place of the guilty son of a father. Palm Sunday is all about the hope of salvation, the desire for freedom, peace, and justice. The crowds didn't know that Jesus' silence would lead to their salvation. Isaiah 53, verses 5 through 7 says, He was pierced because of our rebellion, crushed because of our crimes, and he bore the punishment that made us whole. By his wounds we are healed. Like sheep we had all wandered away, each going its own way, but the Lord let fall on him all our crimes. He was oppressed and tormented, but he didn't open his mouth. Like a lamb being brought to the slaughter, like a ewe silent before her shears, he didn't open his mouth. There's a deep temptation to go straight from the shouts of Hosanna to the Alleluias of resurrection. It would be easy to skip past Holy Week and the inner confrontation of ourselves in the story as we acknowledge that in some way or another, we participate in the suffering and death of Jesus. Whether we're the religious people who claim there's only one way to worship God, or we're Peter and we deny him, or we're Judas and we betray him, or we're Pilate and we simply seek to satisfy the crowds, we might be all or none of these, but we are all the guilty who are set free. Like those first followers of Jesus, we don't always know where the path of discipleship will lead us. So maybe it is easier for us to wave some palm branches and then gather again next Sunday to celebrate the resurrection and skip the rest. Skip the quiet service of Maundy Thursday and the suffering of Good Friday. Skip the choice between the way of Jesus and the way of this world. Maybe it is easier to show up for the parade and ignore the paradox. Let's not skip it. Let's be transformed by a God whose power is made perfect, not in might, but in the vulnerability of love, who comes on the back of a donkey instead of a war horse, and whose greatest victory is found not on a battlefield, but in an empty tomb. We will choose once again to follow Jesus. Palm and Passion Sunday reminds us that hope and despair will travel together on this road. We will despair at the brokenness of our world and of our lives, and we will place our hope in the one who travels alongside us, the one who leads us onward in the strange parade. Hosanna, we cry. Save us, we pray. And then, picking up our cloaks and our crosses, we make our way behind Jesus, knowing that he already has traveled this road, and he knows how to lead us in this parade as we move from pain to praise, from suffering to salvation, from death to everlasting life. Amen.
I invite us now to go to God in a time of prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we have gathered this day to worship and praise you. We began our worship with palm branches in hand, remembering the time when Jesus rode down from the east wall to Jerusalem, where people were shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, save us now. And the crowds wanted to be satisfied with ways that you would come and take care of things. And we know as we read scripture that Jesus didn't satisfy the crowds that day. But we know that Jesus loves the world. And we're so thankful that even though the crowds were not satisfied, your love demonstrated in the life and death and resurrection of Jesus proves your great love for us and what you've offered to us in that life. So be with us, O Lord, as we share in this journey. We're thankful for this Lenten journey that we've been on these many weeks and for the opportunities we've had to lay certain things down and to take hold of newness of life as we've made this journey up to Jerusalem. We're thankful for the discoveries along the way, for the hope that we have, for the joy that we have in you. But now this journey seems to go into overdrive this week. And there'll be moments and times we want to turn away when we don't want to pay attention because of what took place on that cross. But be with us, O Lord, and guide us that we might have meditations and reflections that will run deep, that we might be mindful and ever aware of all that you are and what you offer to us each and every day. Lord, be with us as we seek to pick up the cross and follow Jesus. Be with us as we walk the way of suffering, that we might also gather on Sunday to rejoice in great victory. Guide us, we pray, in the week ahead. Lead the meditations so that truly would be not just a holy week because it says this is a holy week for us, but it's a holy week for us because we are open to your love, to your way, to your guidance, to your light. Lord, as we come before you, we pray for the areas in our families and the life of the church where there's brokenness and disease. We look to you for your healing presence, for your healing touch. Lord, we lift up to you those who mourn this day as well, especially the people of Great Bridge Middle School, and all who mourn the loss of their assistant principal this week. Be with the Weck family. Be with all the students and staff, we pray. Surround them with your love and care. Lord, together we pray for the McMillan family, Alicia, Hunter, Mary, Michael, Cheryl, Mark, David, our church staff, for Belle, for Lindsay, Hannah, Jim, Monica, and Jaron, for Clee and Paul, Betty, Diane, John, Stephen, Jeffrey, Ellie, EE, and NE. For our military and frontline workers, for Georgette, for Joan and Adrian and Donald, Nathan, and the Sanderlin family. Lord, we do pray, O Lord, for the people in Israel and Palestine. We pray, O Lord, for your peace. And just as we are quick to wave palm branches, may we also be as quick to offer the olive branch of peace. Where there's discord and hatred, may ambassadors of that peace rise up and be willing to stand in the gap when there are injustices. Continue, Lord, to guide your church as we move forward in faith, as we seek to be the church you're calling us to be. This we ask in the blessed name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, I invite the ushers to come forward as we share now on a time of our offering of tithes and gifts. Let's pray. Lord, for this time of worship, we do give you thanks and for the opportunities we've had to gather together. And now we offer these gifts to you. Use them always to bring glory to you and to strengthen the witness of your church here at Great Bridge as we seek to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ in word, sign, and deed. Amen.
As our Lenten season comes to a close, I want to share with you once more about our Lenten offering, the Soul Shop, which is a program that seeks to bring awareness to suicide prevention. Suicide is the most preventable cause of death, but talking about suicide makes us uncomfortable. Most of us don't even want to say the word, but talking about suicide removes the stigma and saves lives. Twice as many people die by suicide than homicide. 12 out of 200 are likely thinking about suicide. 3 out of 20 youth. 33% of people have lost someone to suicide. That includes me and others on our staff. Including staff, I know of at least 10 people in our congregation who have lost someone or more than one someone to suicide. Henry David Thoreau said the greatest mass of men and women lead lives of quiet desperation. The goal of the Soul Shop is to help people move from quiet desperation to honest conversation about suicide. When most of us think about suicide in Scripture, we think about Judas and his regret for betraying Jesus. But Judas is one of the most hated characters in Scripture, and right or wrong, most of us likely don't feel too much compassion for him. But there are other mentions of suicide in Scripture. Job cried out, "If I say my bed will comfort me, my couch will ease my complaint, then you frighten me with dreams and terrify me by visions, so that my soul would choose suffocation, death rather than my pains." If that's not desperation, I don't know what is. In the story of the woman who had been bleeding for 12 years, she is so desperate for healing that she reaches out and touches the hem of Jesus' robe within a crowd of people pressed around him. Jesus felt the power leave him, and he stops and turns around and sees her. The call of God is for us to stop and turn around and see those who are desperate and suffering. When you support the Soul Shop, you are helping to stop the most preventable cause of death. You are helping to save life. Thank you for your consideration of giving to this important work. Let us stand together and sing the doxology.
Remain standing as you are able to sing our closing hymn, What Wondrous Love Is This, number 292.
With the spirit of Hosanna, knowing that Christ has come to save us. Let us go into this week with holy meditation. I look forward to seeing you throughout the week and next Sunday. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.